Hello, Matt.
Hi. I'm putting myself in the missile silo for socialism today.
You're ready to launch?
Yes, I am.
Right.
Can you hit the button? It's really tight and cramped in here.
I will hit the button. Countdown. 3, 2, 1. Oh, wait, shit. I forgot. Where are we going? We got to put in coordinates for where we're going.
Yeah.
So
yeah, please.
That's what we're going to do today, hopefully. This should be quick paced 50 minutes of describing where we're going.
Yeah.
What would a socialist world look like?
The no bullshit blueprint for socialism.
So this is going to be the one where we talk about the Golden Square again and what socialism would look like. To get us started this week, just as a launch point for the discussion and a set of references and thinking about all of this, connecting the many dots of the evolving imaginations about socialism in the public discourse, there are a series of articles, a little mixtape we made this week that I shared with you earlier. The first of which is a reference to the Freedom Budget for All Americans, budgeting our resources 1966 to 1975 to achieve freedom from want, and a story in The Atlantic from a couple of years ago. I'm just recapping this.
2018.
Yeah, from 2018. But again, 1966, we've mentioned this a few times over the course of conversations. The civil rights movement and Philip Randolph, Bayard Rustin, Martin Luther King, used as the backbone for the Poor People's Campaign, put forward in 1966 a document called the Freedom Budget for All Americans, building upon FDR's idea of freedom from want.
I mean, Randolph and Rustin were key figures in the March on Washington, and Bayard Rustin was black and gay, closeted purposely to the outside world because it was so difficult at the time. But they basically offer in this document stuff on like a Jobs Guarantee Act, and using the actual growth of the U.S. economy, which was growing very fast, to put that into a Jobs Guarantee Act. So, you know, some really interesting things in there. And then, of course, the first federal minimum wage then was $2, but would be $15 now as a basic precept of a bottom for pay. Like, you never goes below that. So there's some really cool things about it. And it tells us a history that's larger than just Voting Rights Act.
Well, basically, the platform of democratic socialists in the UK, in the US right now, this is the platform. It was here in 1966. It was a practical, feasible, step-by-step plan for abolishing poverty in America within 10 years.
And it had 100 major signers on it. So it had a long, big support from union, black civil rights strugglers, anti-war activists. It had a lot of support from different people in society that were trying to end the oppressive systems of the United States.
Yeah, it's an important document historically to look at. It lays out objectives of a federal jobs guarantee, an increased minimum wage, as you said, a guaranteed basic income, expanded unemployment. Like we mentioned last week, all of those things, not just one of them.
To end poverty. Actually just get it done.
Yeah. Decent housing for all, universal health care, cleaning up air and water, and full educational opportunity for everybody. So,
and it's one of the first platforms that actually talks about air pollution in there. So we even see the birth of some ecological awareness about the nature of work and industry and what it was doing.
Really a kind of no bullshit socialist plan that doesn't even bring up socialism. It's not tied to some doctrinaire notion about socialism. It's just, let's just fucking do it.
It's an expansion of the social democratic welfare state that did exist in a much larger way when we think of welfare back in the 60s versus now. Definitely the expansion of what I would say the social democratic welfare state that existed then.
Yeah, a way to get to the material means for a dignified life on the basis that freedom from want is the basic freedom from which all of us flow.
Excellent.
I think a real touchstone for us in thinking about the Golden Square and for this discussion about it.
It's number one because we think this is like the thing that we should really revisit.
Yeah.
And everyone should check out that link on our show notes.
Secondly, we looked again at a recent piece in The New Yorker from Kionga Yamada Taylor, where she revisited her discussion about the Combahee River Collective in her discussions with Barbara Smith.
Kionga Yamada Taylor actually locates her own personal life in a very touching, poignant way to her mother's experiences being a black and female and a single mother, having a graduate degree but not being treated well, and then having to quit to just try her own business because of the oppressive circumstance of people that were far less educated than her, and then reflects on that to the, you know, the 60s with the River Combahee Collective, with a lot of major black civil rights figures that were working all kinds of other issues, women's rights, anti-war, and how they noticed how in every one of those movements, black women were at the bottom of them.
Yeah.
And they were ignored or made invisible, even in liberation movements that were supposed to be anti-oppressive. And so the Combahee Collective, coming from Harriet Tubman's, you know, the phrase of the army that released 750 plus slaves, that it was a political action. It wasn't just a state of being. And so it actually forms the term identity politics, which has been co-opted and manipulated and butchered in all kinds of horrible ways. But Yamada Taylor talks about how that type of feminism, rooted within a socialism, rooted within a kind of Black liberation struggle, was so pivotal to her that she couldn't really understand it when she was in college. And she had to revisit it later with the Ferguson stuff. So it really is a great article where you combine the personal with the political.
She talks about how the Combahee River Collective approached their political struggles that brought them in conflict with the intertwined malignancies of capitalism, racism, sexism, and poverty, and that they believed that if Black women were successful in their struggles and movements, they would have an impact far beyond their immediate demands.
If they were emancipated, then that meant everybody else was emancipated. And that's interesting because of Document 1, Martin Luther King says, if Black people have these rights, it means everybody else has these rights. Yep. So in the Freedom Budget, it makes the same claim that if we have centered on Black liberation and Black struggle, then the basis of everything, everybody's been lifted up because Black people are always on the bottom of every economic aspect of American society, have been since the very foundation of this genocidal colonial state.
Yeah. Because for them to be free, as they said, it would necessitate the destruction of all the systems of oppression. Mm-hmm. And she quotes it a couple times, which are, I think, worth reading here from the statement. We need to articulate the real class situation of persons who are not merely raceless, sexless workers, but for whom racial and sexual oppression are significant determinants in their working and economic lives. Although we are in essential agreement with Marx's theory, as it applies to the very specific economic relationships he analyzed, we know that his analysis must be extended further in order for us to understand our specific economic situation as Black women. And further, we realize that the liberation of all oppressed peoples necessitates the destruction of the political economic systems of capitalism and imperialism, as well as patriarchy. We are socialists, they said, because we believe that work must be organized for the collective benefit of those who do the work and create the products and not for the profit of the bosses. Material resources must be equally distributed among those who create these resources. We are not convinced, however, that a socialist revolution that is not also a feminist and anti-racist revolution will guarantee our liberation. Right. And this way continues to be such an important touchstone in thinking about socialism today and informing our actions, activities, and objectives.
And we're seeing the effects of this because the Ferguson protests were led by Black women, sometimes queer, sometimes LGBT identified. And we now have the Floyd uprising. And once again, Black women of color are leading that and making the most multiracial successful protests in American history. Yeah. It's anywhere from 15 to 26 million people. So we're seeing that being realized through the Floyd uprisings.
And you may have noticed that the popularity of socialism being evidenced among other places by more inclusion in a magazine you wouldn't have expected, probably, if you go Teen Vogue.
That was part of the upside down world of 2016, is Teen Vogue got kind of rebranded into kind of a socialist magazine or anti-capitalist magazine. And we started seeing all these weird things like, what is Karl Marx, you know, in 2016, while we have this fucking moron as president. So, and this article is called Socialist Feminism. What is it and how can it replace corporate girl boss feminism? And it goes into the whole discussion about girl boss feminism, or what's sometimes called lean-in feminism, and how it really doesn't meet Generation Z and millennial experiences, and how socialist feminism is rerouting those energies towards a more emancipatory lens.
Yeah, this is a piece by Sarah Leonard in Teen Vogue from just earlier this year in May, and she does reference the Combahee River Collective as socialist feminists and says that today socialist feminism can help us build a beautiful vision of life beyond capitalism. We can revalue life, care for one another above profit. So that's a good piece there. Next one was a piece in Jacobin from May by Ben Burgess called Capitalism Isn't Working, But What Would a Viable Socialist System Look Like? And this article, he says, this is what a viable socialist system could look like. We can say that we want radically democratic and decentralized planning rather than top-down planning, but consideration of what this would look like can make socialism sound even less attractive to ordinary people. So he says, well, basically, let's at least start with what is often called market socialism.
A movement to worker cooperatives and worker ownership.
Yeah.
And that can be simple. It can be stuff like the German system where the corporate boardroom is made up of employees and employers at the bottom rungs of the company.
Yeah.
But it also includes unitary worker cooperatives that are worker-owned, worker-run, and the profits are shared equally among the members.
Yeah. He basically says, well, the state would run things like finance sector and power companies and healthcare and education, and then a market economy of worker-owned co-ops would run everything else. That's it. Period. Boom. There you go. There's a blueprint for socialism. Mm-hmm. That basic idea of, you know, nationalize things and then worker co-ops or everything else as a sort of basic blueprint in economic terms of what much discourse around envisioning socialism today entails. a similar sort of take in a much longer piece.
Much longer.
Also in Jacobin by Sam Gindin from March of last year. We need to say what socialism will look like. Spends a lot more time looking at the evolving Marxist territory of envisioning socialism.
It's very workerist and economist in terms of its focus of what socialism is. So it doesn't really talk about a rights-based framework. So that's where we would differ in that approach. We do find it, you know, to be useful for people that want to have a history about the means of production and worker logic and participation in social settings when it comes to work. But it doesn't really talk about what rights should be for people in a socialist world.
Yeah, it's mostly concerned with what it says, the question of can the concentrated power that comes with comprehensive planning be democratized? So he takes up this notion of central planning. And does socialism just mean central planning, or does it mean more than that? So he talks about it's not just a matter of planning versus markets, but planning and markets, saying that some markets, just like Ben Burgess said, should be banished under socialism, while others would be run in through worker-owned co-ops. And he also mentions here, one thing's interesting is this idea of a social wage. He doesn't give much time to this. There's a little jewel hidden in the middle of this piece here that's talking about.
But it's a part that we really wanted to see more from. Yeah.
He talks about the social wage, free healthcare, education, transit, childcare, and subsidized housing and culture being a core part of the socialist world. He just sort of moves right past it, though, because I guess the economic mechanisms are more interesting. But basically leads with a framework that he says advances the credibility of socialism, that is a collection of workplace collectives, markets, sectoral councils, spatial community planning, layered planning, central planning board, liberal political freedoms, and embracing the messiness of socialism. So according to Sam Gindin, that's what socialism will look like. It's not a could look like, should look like, it will.
The March of Marx.
And then finally, we read an article by Nathan J. Robinson from Current Affairs from March of 2008.
Current Affairs.
Called Socialism as a Set of Principles. So basically putting forward an argument that socialism, as embraced by and advocated for by millennials of his generation, describes a set of principles that we want the economic and political system to conform to, as opposed to a full economic
platform and agenda. Yeah, and I find this to be really noteworthy and gets a lot done. It's very fluid and breezy, a really nice article.
Yeah.
And I think it just sets principles of like, well, look, socialism is when we allow people to achieve their full capacities as human beings, the full flowering of who they are.
Yeah, everyone should have the most fulfilling possible life is the phrase he uses. It says that millennial embrace of socialism means that they measure any economic system by the degree to which it is humane and democratic.
And he has a great part where he says that if you say democratic socialism, it's actually a redundancy, because socialism, if it's going to exist, has to be as deeply democratic as possible.
Has to be democratic, yeah. How can it not be? So
that's why he makes jokes about what he calls the quote-unquote socialist systems of Mao's and Stalinism. They weren't democratic by nature, and they're the dictatorship of a proletariat within a political structure. So you had a monopoly power within the Communist Party. So that's not what we want. We can't have that in the 21st century.
Really, what we're concerned with and why you see democratic socialists with platforms that are basically a mirror of the freedom budget for all Americans is we want a system that gives everybody the most fulfilling life possible and that it's humane and democratic.
And that it functions on a rights-based framework.
Yeah.
And that we simply play with the state or the non-state actors to meet those rights. And that's kind of the North Star of human decency. And that's the way in which we work, that we need a rights-based framework.
So what would a viable socialist system look like, Matt?
It'd be the Golden Square, which we've talked about in prior episodes, which would be a no-bullshit blueprint for socialism. So food, shelter, healthcare, education, to all, decommodified as much as possible and granted from cradle to grave.
The Golden Square as a no bullshit blueprint for socialism is not some complex, esoteric, dogmatic political theory that can be used for nefarious aims where we get lost in the mechanisms of designing some complex economy. It is a simple and obvious acknowledgement of universal human dignity and collective moral responsibility that the cornerstones of a dignified life, food, shelter, healthcare, education, we need to treat them and enshrine them as human rights, basic human rights, guarantee them to every person on the planet. It is a clear program for realizing the values of equality, democracy, community, the values that we've talked about in a number of episodes that Eric Olin-Wright outlined. He decried capitalism because it prohibits those values, it impedes those values, and instead cultivates competitive individualism and privatized consumerism.
And we can just call it privatized hoarding, right?
Yeah.
And that's another way of thinking about it.
So, okay, but if we were to be moving towards the Golden Square and the world started to shape around that in that direction, if we were to provide those things to everyone, if this was the social contract, how exactly would this work? How would the world be different? How would it be the same?
And the arc of this is a kind of practical backbone that moves from people over profit, that there's a flipping of the script, which is profit over people. And that the increasingly every 3 years, every 5 years, every 6 years, we see people being moved over profit. And that's just the trajectory of a decommodified world.
Is a common slogan on the left, people over profit. But what does that mean in practical terms? What would that actually look like? Part of the beauty and the power of the Golden Square is its straightforward simplicity. As a no bullshit blueprint for socialism, it's a simple, infinitely scalable principle that organizes in complex world. We talked about this before too, how part of what so many have, even back to Marx, sort of marveled at in capitalism's productive capacity was it was simple as a starting point for organizing the world. It didn't have to prescribe all the parameters of it. It's just private property, extraction of profit, there you go. Mm-hmm. You're off and running and everything follows from that.
In place of this, we need a golden system institution. It's a seed that we must plant and cultivate from which a better world will actually grow.
And it should be our new social contract for society.
These core principles, core values, we could call it more likely, they're the necessities for life, food, shelter, healthcare, and education. We must hit that drum, announce that song, and sing it in a collective chorus. It must be enshrined as essential human rights and guaranteed to every human on the planet, regardless of any identity.
Yep. This assertion that food, shelter, healthcare, and education should be human rights is an acknowledgement of a simple moral truth that we have a collective responsibility to provide all people with the material means to live a dignified life. This is straightforward. It seems so dumbfoundingly obvious to me. You said this before. I don't know how this is not the thing that is used as the organizing principle for society already. It hasn't been for millennia, but there are some precedents that this is built off of.
Yeah, the Golden Rule, which predates all forms of major religions, so Buddhism, Christianity, Islam. The Golden Rule is the trace fire lens, the origin story, the seed and the flower, where we treat others as you'd want to treat yourself. And from each according to ability to each according to need is the socialist principle, another outgrowth, a more concrete measure of that idea of reciprocity.
And this was seen again in FDR's Four Freedoms from his 1941 State of the Union speech in the freedom from want that was part of informing Article 25 and 26 of the United Nations Declaration of Human Rights in 1948, something that we continue to not live up to anywhere. When we talk about the Golden Square, when we use the terms food, shelter, healthcare, and an education, we're using them in an expansive way. They're the cornerstones of dignified life. We're not talking about these four terms in a reductive kind of way.
Yeah, we're not talking about food as in just like a block of cheese or shelter as just a house. Shelter can be much more things than that. Food can be much more things than just a block of cheese.
We're talking about food. We're talking about clean air and clean water and everything that is the material means to sustain. We're talking about shelter that's the means of protection, housing being one of those things, clothing, infrastructure, keeping each other safe, healthcare as the means to heal, and not just physical health, but mental health.
And also prevention. And it's not just to heal what's hurt, but also to prevent what could be hurt later on.
In education, the means to grow and the opportunity to engage in intellectual pursuits and not just until you're 18, 19, 20, 24 years old, but through your whole life.
So we need food, shelter, healthcare, my beautiful motherfuckers, to sustain, protect, and heal and grow as a human civilization.
Remember, we're not talking about these as merely a framework of opportunity, access, or affordability.
Access bullshit.
One of the things, even back to the freedom budget and much of the discourse, even with democratic socialists today, is still in the framework of opportunity, access, or affordability.
We see that most famously back in 2017, maybe, when Ted Cruz and Bernie Sanders had a debate about Medicare or healthcare as a human right.
Right.
And Ted Cruz kept framing it as an access question. And Bernie said, quite rightly, access doesn't mean you can get that thing because you have to have certain amount of money.
Yeah.
It just, as Nathan J. Robinson says in his article, you have the potential to go to Disney World doesn't mean you can actually fucking afford to go to Disney World, right?
Yeah.
And so access, forget about that, rights.
The myth that keeps American culture moving forward and keeps it as the engine destroying the planet is the promise that everybody has the opportunity to become rich and famous. Well, fuck that shit. I don't want to be fucking rich. I don't want to be fucking famous. I want to be fucking free. So we're talking about these things as guaranteed provisions, mm-hmm. which means abolishing the cost of living. The fact that it's a common sense sort of phrase that we just take without even batting an eyelash, that there's a cost of living. Oh, the cost of living's high there. Like, what the fuck?
It's like, I want access to breathe.
Yeah.
Like, what the fuck does that mean? I don't want access to breathe. It's assumed that I have the right to breathe.
Yeah.
But maybe not, you know? So forget the cost of living. What the hell does that mean?
We need to work to abolish it. That's what this no bullshit blueprint is about, is abolishing this cost of living. When we talk about the Golden Square, we're talking about the material necessity. So it's not only a moral assertion and an acknowledgement of a simple moral truth. It is a material framework. It combines in an elegant and simple way a moral truth and material necessity in a way that is without bullshit. We also should undertake these things in a feminist, anti-racist way, but also to pursue each of these to be guaranteed as human rights to everyone in unconditional, universal, and lifelong terms. Everybody without condition should have these things provided for their whole life.
And when we talk about provisions, we're not talking about like some type of World War II rationing where we get cups of beans in the can. No. It's provisions that are post-scarcity in nature.
You will just give you a tent, a burlap tent, and a can of beans, and a box of Band-Aids, and a Bible.
And some seed packets. No, none of that shit. Post-scarcity, beautifully made, beautifully composed, beautifully realized, provisions as in rights.
So these should be unconditional, universal, and lifelong. We should also continually produce these things at the highest quality possible. This is consistent with what was the best parts of modernism, which were the aims to provide things in a universal way.
No doubt.
To design things in a way that's for everybody unconditionally.
No doubt.
To do less, as Dieter Rahm says, to do less, but to do it better.
No doubt.
So we don't need a bunch of crap. Mm-hmm. We don't need a bunch of tchotchkes.
High carbon shit.
Yeah.
What we make should be durable, logical, efficient, and compassionate.
Yeah. Also, thirdly, they should be produced with a goal of net positive impact on the biosphere. So again, our aim should be to produce these things in the highest quality possible, but with the least impact on ecosystems.
The types of things we manufacture could actually have multiplier effects on the environment that when it's being produced.
Yeah.
And this is something we could think about. Like instead of having a place like Iowa that's just all fucking corn and soy, that you could be planting a more diverse set of bioforms that make for better corn, that make for better soy because of the biodiversity of the way that you plant. And it takes a little bit more thinking, takes a little bit of time, but the back-end outcomes of that are much more maximally beneficial.
As we mentioned and advocated for in episode 30, when we talked about A Planet to Win, that the Golden Square provides a moral and practical foundation and should therefore be the beating heart of a radical global Green New Deal. If we're talking about a framework for a New Deal for society and a Green New Deal for society and a radical Green New Deal for society, that the thing at the heart of it, the project that is the contract at the heart of that should be the Golden Square.
Full stop, we must decommodify the means to a dignified life. This is not the utopian sphere. This is not the spiritual and manifest emotional things that have to be solved after the Golden Square is achieved, but that this is the basis of any dignified life on the planet.
And yes, communism, but we've got to get to socialism first, presumably. If there's a shortcut to utopia, great, let's take it, but we're in a lot of shit now. This is barbarism now. Let's choose socialism.
If the governor of California is asking Australia and Canada to help out because we don't have enough firefighters, you know, we're in a big shit show.
So the global economy of goods and services has thus far been constructed at the expense of people and the planet and in service exclusively for the unmitigated pursuit of wealth of a tiny tyrannical minority. So what we need to do is redesign and retool the global economy by removing profit and debt from the system so that we can put health, well-being, care, survival of people and the planet first. So Golden Square is a no-bullshit blueprint for socialism. It means decommodifying basic needs. And decommodifying basic needs is a process argue, of removing the bullshit.
Profit is bullshit.
Yeah. Say it again.
Profit is bullshit.
Say it again.
Profit is bullshit.
Say it again.
Profit is bullshit.
Debt is bullshit.
Money is bullshit.
Profit is theft.
Extracting more money than it costs to produce something. Why are we doing that?
This is the basic underlying tenet of capitalism. Let's put in X number of dollars of capital so that I can get far more in return. That is theft. Mm. That is theft. And it is fucking bullshit. And it's totally unnecessary as a way of producing things in the world. And debt, I would argue, is a manufactured burden that is meant to justify inequality.
And it creates conditions of subservience in our culture, among young, among old, among the weak.
In no way is debt a practical necessity. Just think about it. Even when you take on a big load of debt, like a house, what is it in reality? The house is already there. Mm-hmm. The house is there. Why should you be in some manufactured trap? It is not a practical necessity. It is a moral calculation based on myths that enshrine hierarchy.
The book Debt, The First 5,000 Years by anthropologist David Graeber goes through these kinds of concepts about our complex notions of debt, that it's a very ambivalent thing.
In the beginning of the book, he uses a little anecdote about being at a party and a conversation with an economist about debt and the common phrase that surely one has to pay one's debts, and realizing that that assertion, which we think of as common sense, that, well, surely anybody has to repay their debts, that it's not an economic statement, it is a moral statement. Mm-hmm. And he says that the very fact that we don't know what debt is, the very flexibility of the concept, is the basis of its power. If history shows us anything, he says, it is that there's no better way to justify relations founded on violence to make such relations seem moral than by reframing them in the language of debt above all, because it immediately makes it seem that it's the victim who's doing something wrong.
And one of the key takeaways from the book is that the debt systems in ancient societies got so unequal, so corrosive, that it actually questioned the legitimacy of the state and the monarchy rulers. And so you had to actually remove debt. And that's why you have Jubilee in the Bible, is because they're actually, it's not always a moral statement. Sometimes it's an actual crisis of the fundamental nature of the society that you live in. And that debt Jubilee is one way to reset the parameters of what is legitimate.
Debt Jubilee now.
Yes. Fuck yes. Cancel all rent.
So decommodification process of removing bullshit. Profit is bullshit. Debt is bullshit. Money is bullshit. Profit is bullshit because it's theft. Debt is bullshit because it's a manufactured burden that enshrines hierarchy. Money is bullshit because it's a shared hallucination.
It's just shared. It's just shared. You, if I painted my dollar purple, you'd still take it because it looks somewhat the same. But if I ripped it up, you wouldn't take it after I taped it up. So we get to decide what's hallucination and what's not.
Sure, at different points in history, there were different foundations for monetary systems, different standards.
Coin systems, coin history.
But we've long since been floating in complete make-believe land. Not to say that even using a standard like rarer metals mined from the earth is in itself a legitimate standard for a monetary system. But even since 1971, when the Nixon administration moved U.S. off of the gold standard, it's just been fiat money or make-believe money. It's monopoly money.
Through the violence and legitimacy of a war state, right?
So yeah, it's no different than monopoly money. That's why can't we use monopoly money to go pay for things?
That's how currency often started. You needed the small towns to feed your soldiers as they moved through different regions. So the coin system was pushed onto the communities that didn't necessarily want the coins.
I'm going to go buy a Monopoly board game so I can use the money in it to pay my rent this month. You know, ostensibly, fiat money is just a social agreement about value. But as we said many times before, we talk about value, we talk about cost, and whenever the question of how are you going to pay for it, money, shared hallucination, that's not real cost, that's not real value. So real cost, real value comes from the use of time, energy, and resources.
That's the real cost, that's the real value.
Yeah. So we must remove profit and debt from the system. And we need to create new, just alternatives to our existing fiat monetary systems. So removing profit and debt from a global economy, well, Jesus Christ, that seems like impossible. How the fuck are we going to do that?
It's been done in the past. It's, you know, there has been debt forgiveness. There has been debt jubilee. It's not like it can't be done again.
It's just a keystroke. That's all it is.
It's digits on screen.
You can't pay your rent and you're going to get evicted because you can't pay your rent. That's just keystrokes. That's the fix, is a couple of keystrokes. Mm-hmm.
The Fed does it every day.
Just put some more dollars in some accounts. That's mm-hmm. it. Mm-hmm. And that's actually how it happens. So thinking about removing profit and debt might seem hard because it is almost one and the same with our imagining of how the world works. Mm-hmm. It is imprinted in the DNA of society, in the DNA of our culture, in our own DNA, in our own understanding of the world, in our relationships. It seems like there's no other way. This is why Mark Fisher's book, Capitalist Realism, this idea that it's easier to imagine the end of the world than the end of capitalism.
Mm-hmm. We have to just decolonize the mind. I mean, this is these myths that are like viruses attached to the neurological framework of people's brains that have to be really, like, it's like the alien and from the movie Alien with those little succubus characters, those spiders on your face, they're sucking your brain. You have to just pull them. We have to remove them.
But in fact, this will be so much easier. What's hard is what we've been doing forever, mm-hmm. what we've been living through our whole lives. This is what's exhausting. Mm-hmm. This is what has got us tired. Enough is enough. Mm-hmm. This pyramid scheme bullshit is fucking exhausting.
I'm as mad as hell and I'm not going to take it anymore. Fuck this shit.
Capitalism likes to tell us, and the preachers of the capitalist gospel like to try to convince us every day that capitalism is about efficiency and it's the best way we can do everything. It's the best way, it's the only way we can have a democratic society, and that it's the most efficient, it's the most equal, it's the most innovative. It's not about those things.
We're seeing this laid to waste through the COVID crisis.
Yeah.
Because the markets are creating the shortages of toilet paper, creating the shortages of food, creating the shortages of PPE masks because of this quote unquote just-in-time economy is a just-in-time piece of shit. And we're now living in a mythology that can no longer reproduce itself in a physical manifestation of the very lack of resources we need for the COVID crisis.
Capitalism isn't characterized by efficiency, equality, or innovation. In fact, it is characterized, and we all know this because we see this every fucking day.
It's put behind the stage curtains.
Yeah. It is characterized by waste, inequality, and violence. Capitalism is not only morally reprehensible, it is completely idiotic.
It doesn't grant equality, freedom, and community to us. No. It doesn't do that. As Eric Olmright says, it fails to do the things it says it does for us.
Let's fucking cancel that shit. We can trade in, like you said, we decolonize our mind and trade in the scarcity logic. Yes, we need to do accounting of things in the world. Mm-hmm. It is a finite planet. Yes. And there are finite resources. Yes. We are using them up at a rapid pace. Yes. But we can trade in our scarcity logic for a logic of long-term sustainability. Mm-hmm. The planet we know won't be around in the universe forever. In 5 billion years, yes, the sun is going to expand to the point that it's going to eat up the Earth. But
as a civilization,
we don't need to race to destroy the planet and burn it to shreds in the next 20 years.
We have to cancel capitalism. Yeah. It's a dick and box ideology. We have to cancel that shit. Put a black bar on it. Edit that shit out.
There you go. Yeah.
We don't need a dick and box economy.
No, we need a culture of shared responsibilities, not individualized burdens. Mm-hmm. This means we need to get rid of this archaic idea about the individualized work ethic. That pulling yourself up by your bootstraps and just work harder. And
see the person as the miracle that they are. Why would I see this organism as, I don't point at a tree and say, you go fucking work.
You go fucking work.
You go fucking work. Hey, hamster, you fucking work. We don't go around to other beings on the planet and say, you fucking work. We know they naturally work because it's their natural effusion of energy and excitement for being a living thing that grants it its autonomy and beauty. And we're saying that to ourselves, like, hey, tree, go fucking work.
Yeah.
Fuck the work ethic.
Yes, there are valuable things in work. Work can be enriching to our lives. I want to work. I want to work. What's keeping me from working are day jobs, participation in this fucking pyramid scheme, racing to get woofy. This is what keeps me from working. I want to work.
Raising children is work, and this country, as well as any other country on this planet, has failed to honor that as work, right? Yeah. It's just out of the stock market. It's out of the economy. How is that not insane?
Yeah. So instead of working hard to get ahead, to compete with everybody else, gimme, we should be working hard to care for each other and the planet. Yes, there's work to be done, but it is care work. That should be the work we're doing.
A matriarchal understanding of our relationships to each other and the earth itself.
What about the workings of economic machinery and what that might look like? So if we take up the things put forth by the two Jacobin articles we referenced, what are we really talking about in terms of market mechanics and economic terms here? What are the frameworks that we would be advocating for that we need to be seeing to make this decommodification process a reality? First off, evaluating existing industries, institutions, companies, corporations. Either democratize or dismantle them. Mm-hmm. And we look at existing companies, existing institutions, existing industries. If it's something we want to keep, mm-hmm. well, then it probably needs to be democratized. Well, it absolutely needs to be democratized.
If it refuses to be democratized, it has to be fully dismantled because of its authoritarian value system.
Or if it's unnecessary, it's harming the planet, like fossil fuel industry, dismantle that.
Yeah.
Things that need to stick around, healthcare industry, democratize that. You know, we've used this phrase now and again.
As a meme we might post. Yeah.
Companies saying that, well, no, we're for...
Black Lives Matter.
Black Lives Matter and sustainability. And we're a green company. Fuck off.
Give your company to the workers. Yes,
Give your company to the workers. Everything needs to transition to public ownership and democratic control. One sort of spectrum for evaluating existing companies and institutions goes from eliminating... to creating. So does it need to go away or do we need to create it new? So either eliminate it, reduce it, preserve it, improve it, or create it.
If there's something that doesn't exist, then we'll have to create it, right? And that's I think, part of the Global Green New Deal and the Golden Square is there's things that we currently don't have as an institution, we might have to create whole cloth.
There are some things that we would approach in society that we would think of either nationalizing that we need to do on a broad scale. I would, in terms of our language, want to update mm-hmm. from nationalizing because we need to work towards a world without borders. And mm-hmm. we probably need to think about more continental mm-hmm. as a better framework for that.
We have to think in terms of Marxist and anarchist traditions because there are things that are better that are locally horizoned through capital or through democratization.
Yes.
But there are things that are so capital intensive that are cost so much money that we have to really think of them on a continental or national level.
Some things, the backbone of organizing the production of these things, we should think of in a continental way, like healthcare.
$3 trillion for Medicare for All. It will cost $3 trillion. So it's a lot of money. Education, most countries outside the United States, because the United States spends its money on military, not education. So the states have to come up with the money for their college systems. But most countries needs lots of capital to develop the university systems, education systems. That's very capital intensive. Healthcare is very capital intensive.
And infrastructure, a low carbon energy grid. We need to finish building out that energy grid and we need to make it low carbon. We need to make it powered by the sun and the wind. And whatever happened to ideas of high-speed bullet trains crisscrossing continents mm-hmm. and shipping systems, so forth and so on. But there are other systems like food production, housing, material sourcing, production.
Like a community land trust, like local CSAs, and the weight of having food sovereignty when climate change disrupts one economy, food can be parceled out from another economy. And the centralization we're seeing with food right now, where too much food is being made in the Central Valley of California and too much meat is being produced in Iowa, as well as corn and soy, is a real crisis because if those places get wiped out, we lose 25%, 50% of food in the United States. And so we're centralizing way too much of food production in tiny little areas rather than creating a network of food solidarity.
Yeah.
And by locally autonomizing those things, when climate crisis hit and impact different parts of this country or different parts of the world, we can move and flex food to different areas.
Yes.
And the centralization of capitalism where all the pork is made in like Tar Heel, North Carolina, or all of the walnuts is just made in Central Valley of California is a real crisis of production.
Yep.
It puts huge water pressures, environmental pressures, toxicity pressures on the water systems by centralizing it there. And we have to de-emphasize this centralization and by localizing food. And housing works best when it's manifest from social relations of the people who live there. And so that's something that would be much more organized on the local level. So there are things that you could take a Marxist trajectory with, like healthcare, education, infrastructure, mm-hmm. but there's things that should be more anarchist in nature, food production and housing construction. That being said, there's overlaps and there'll be some contradictions like infrastructure. Yeah. If we have solar sunflower energy grids, what they talk about in Planet to Win is that you can have a democratization of local energy grids. So there's some overlap here. but not this anarchist-only, Marxist-only approach.
That's why we make a mixtape. Yes, there are some things in the traditionalist Marxist thinking that are sensible and useful, but also we need to be guided by moral principles mm-hmm. and not doctrinaire about the way that we achieve those.
Use anarchism as an ethical yeah. toolkit to look at the systems you're creating to create post-scarcity. So anarchism as a toolkit to see where Marxism overreaches itself.
Fractal approaches. Think about how things can be built in ways that are resilient. So we don't have these points of failure and collapse that are characteristic of our current global system. We must avoid the tired and narrow conceptions of socialism as simply state control or central planning or dictator of the proletariat. Those are the old preconceptions that are used to build the Red Scare about socialism and don't represent current thinking about socialism and shouldn't represent our thinking about how we would envision a socialist world. So we need to use a combination of things informed by anarchist ethics. So self-determination and central planning.
Autonomy plus mutual aid.
Non-market goods and services plus markets for some discretionary goods and services.
Sortition and the drawing of lots from the American public or continental populations and elections.
People's assemblies and parliamentary bodies.
Democratic workplaces plus entrepreneurial enterprises when needed.
Combinations of all of those things and more. We're not doctrinaire about some kind of economic systems blueprint that has to conform to some 19th century notions about political economy. We should be flexible, resilient, determined above all else to meet the golden square, to provide a dignified life and a democratic society to live in. So when we're thinking about the problems about production, envisioning the problems of producing the golden square, we should plan on what and how much to produce based on the needs and desires of the community, not on bets for profit in the casino
global capitalism, right?
Yeah. Yeah.
And we can arrange and systematize complex, decentralized global markets of goods and services based on these things, cooperation, communication, collaboration, and not fucking competition. Push that dick in a box out of my way.
Every 2 minutes, somebody on TV is trying to tell you that competition is the best incentive for human beings and the only way that we can organize the world, that it is part of our human nature to be competitive. Fuck that bullshit. Mm-hmm. I reject that premise. Rutger Bregman, who in 2014 put out the book Utopia for Realists about UBI as a TED Talk on advocating for a universal basic income, his latest book that he put out is called Humankind, A New History of Human Nature. That is It's a counter to that popular mythology, the popular common sense that human nature is all about competition.
And let's remember that ideology, that Thomas Hobbesian ideology, has serviced capitalist captains of capitalism quite well. They like that mythology.
Captain capitalism.
They like that mythology and they've been selling it to us even though it's not really rooted in human biology.
When we work in collaboration, in cooperation, with generosity and compassion in our communities, we can accomplish incredible things. You know, we often hear the common phrase, you know, about people wanting to be part of something bigger than themselves. Mm-hmm. And this is what a Green New Deal is. Mm-hmm. What a radical global Green New Deal
logical,
is.
Practical, logical, efficient, and rooted in compassion and solidarity.
Care work, real, valuable, meaningful work available to all of us for the foreseeable future that will allow each of us to be part of something bigger than ourselves. Saving the fucking planet. Wouldn't that be awesome?
Yeah, it's the care that the earth already does itself. It's a matriarchal system of reciprocity and solidarity. And it's not surprising in this highly capitalist society that the more mothering your work and labor, the less you're paid or acknowledged. So the more matriarchal your job is, the less likely you're to be paid or celebrated.
Yes. And like you said, the global pandemic has made all the more evident the fact that we are all connected, that our lives are intertwined around the globe, and that the emancipation of any of us is going to require the emancipation of all. So we need to start acting like how the world actually is, mm-hmm. not this manufactured
mythology
world. So what would be some steps to decommodifying?
Alcoholics Anonymous for socialism.
I haven't outlined 12, but maybe we can get it up to 12. But first and foremost, before we even get to a step, is the elimination of state violence. Abolish the police. abolish the police, prison, military, industrial complex. That has to be without question. Even if we had some other conception of an egalitarian future that was not about socialism, whatever, this is in no way compatible with the Golden Square. It is antithetical to what we need to do.
That's step zero. Step one is to tell the truth. Formal acknowledgments that we need to decommodify basic fucking human rights. Food, shelter, healthcare, and education should be granted to all. Free provisions to all, and made sure that they're part of the everyday aspect, and make it legally binding.
So unlike the UN Declaration of Human Rights, which is not legally binding, let's start to make in your city, in your state, and through congressional resolutions, through the existing legislative tools and UN agreements, let's make these legally binding. Step two, we need to tax the rich, churches, corporations, millionaires, billionaires, tax them.
Step three, expand the welfare state.
Step four, a job guarantee. Everybody should have a right to a job.
Step five, remove the profit motive.
Step six, we need to reclaim, retool, redistribute, repurpose the existing wasteful products of capitalist society to upcycle them into the building blocks for an egalitarian world.
Step seven, establish democracy, money out of politics, worker co-ops.
And step eight, we need to demolish bureaucracies. No more administrators, no more managers. We need to get rid of this unnecessary management layer. Get rid of the lobbyists, get rid of the lawyers. So that's a framework. Tell the truth, tax the rich, expand the welfare state, jobs guarantee, remove the profit motive, reclaim, retool, redistribute, and repurpose, establish democracy, and demolish bureaucracy. So decommodifying each of the four cornerstones of the Golden Square, food, shelter, healthcare, education, there are existing programs as leverage points, as symbiotic transformations, to use Eric Olin-Wright's phrase, to be used to expand towards these.
They're part of a kind of strategic logics for eroding capitalism. Yeah. So with food, we see localized food production, the building of co-ops, the possibility of a larger co-op of small businesses that all maintain under a network of solidarity. SNAP for all, food should never be something you have to ask or beg for. Community kitchens and weekly grocery box deliveries from your local CSAs and community co-ops. So those are some of the things for food.
We have used to be referred to as food stamps, SNAP. Imagine, how would you have free food? Well, everybody has a debit card for food. There you go.
Yeah.
We expand that for everybody. So SNAP for all. In terms of shelter, there's lots of things that we refer to in terms of building upon the strong traditions of Red Vienna and socialist housing and plans for public housing and the plan from A Planet to Win to provide low carbon homes for all. We got many straightforward things that we can do to end housing segregation, to move towards localized material sourcing, establishing community land trusts like the project you're working on in the Inland Empire in Southern California, to move towards more localized clothing manufacturing and public ownership and democratic control of infrastructure and utility companies, and creating a global network, like you said, of interdependent networks of mutual aid for emergency
which we're seeing with COVID in some sense too, these mutual aid things. And then for healthcare, obviously, Medicare for all.
Yeah.
Nationalized, universal, single payer, everybody in, nobody out. That's the phrase that was used for SB 562, California Medicare for All, which might be back in the grooving seat with Biden and his inability to support Medicare for All. So everybody in, nobody out, no copays, no deductibles, zero cost prescriptions, physical, mental, dental, vision, every part of the body gets covered, right? Not just the parts that we don't see, every part and the psychological part.
And at every age.
Yeah. For free childcare, free elder care, and private healthcare, insurance industry, they're vultures, they're vampires, they're squids. Public ownership and democratic control of the pharmaceutical industry so we can develop vaccines for future pandemics rather than constantly existing for the market profit motive. Yeah. National healthcare for union workers. So we have to make sure there's a national healthcare network for worker unions so that they're always in the driving seat when it comes to healthcare considerations.
And for providing education, we need to obviously have zero tuition and zero fee education for everybody at every age. Yes, the popular demand of free public college, but we need to start to go beyond that, to end private schools at every level, to end charter schools, to end school segregation and standardized testing and the corporate takeover of our educational system. We need to decommodify and democratize, again, our whole educational sphere. So if we were to imagine, what would this world look like? How would it be different from this world? How would it be the same? For me, one of the things I like as a framework for envisioning the design of the socialist world is to envision it as a world where every neighborhood looks like, feels like a university campus, where there are grand, walkable public spaces that are free from vehicle traffic and congestion.
And as you walk through those spaces, you're confronted with beauty, plentiful green space, community gardens and parks. Life is flowing out as you walk through that life that is yours.
It's a neighborhood with bold architecture and public spaces, with bold public art that's free from advertising, that isn't littered with the trash of billboards.
That preys on our everyday anxieties that should not even exist.
Neighborhoods that are rich with classrooms, shops, libraries, restaurants, food halls, public markets, grocery co-ops, art galleries, performance spaces, cinemas, research facilities, makerspaces, art studios, media labs, and so on.
And childcare, pre-K, K through 12. Universities often have these that you can go to teach your class and then pick up your kid after your class, walking with a student on the way. And that's something we should see, where the childcare is connected closely with the other forms of work we have to do.
That has hospitals, wellness centers, gyms, sporting facilities, all the infrastructure for healing and for healthcare.
And a mix of medium density, high density, and low density housing, depending on location, context, and technology.
And as transportation hubs for networks of electric buses, trains, subways, and other mass transit. So instead of a few walled off proto-utopias sprinkled throughout the continent, where only the rich can play. These kinds of neighborhood scale environments that are rich with all of these things, grand spaces of bold architecture with everything you need to create the most fulfilling life possible in walking distance and network to all the other neighborhoods, that are all diverse neighborhoods through low carbon, high speed transportation networks. This is what the world could look like. Education would be part of your entire life. So let's make the whole thing look like a well-appointed university campus.
Cradle to grave.
In conclusion,
our coda to end all codas, contrary to popular capitalist mythology, the world we live in is now mostly drab, boring, homogeneous. Capitalism is a homogeneous creating machine. It's depressing and dangerous to live in this environment.
It's overrun with militarized, monopolized, market-worshipping malls, mini-marts, Megaplexes, McMansions, and miles of Milquetoast Suburbs, stacked with supersized SUVs.
Fuck this shit.
Today, we must choose between socialism or more of this neoliberal capitalist barbarism.
One path leads to utopia, the other to endless oblivion.
The choice is so dumbfoundingly obvious.
The socialist tomorrow that we can begin building today,
based on the Golden Square's no bullshit blueprint, is a tomorrow that is inclusive, accessible, sustainable, vibrant, colorful, diverse, dynamic, enriching, expansive, exciting, innovative, joyful, fun, restful, and queer as fuck.
We can't even put this on a billboard. It's so fucking beautiful. We wouldn't want to because it's a launch pad, not a goddamn billboard in your neighborhood. Let's start building it now.
The Golden Square is the launch pad to a flourishing utopian future. Let's fucking launch this rocket.
Epic! Mic drop. We just dropped the mic on you. Vote that, baby. And the dick in the box is gone.
Get your fucking dick out of my face.
Justin Timberlake, sorry.
Fuck off. Give your company to the workers and get your fucking dick out of my face.
I want tomatoes, not your dick.
All right. We'll continue.
Thanks for joining
more
us.
More of this jubilee next week. Right. Cheers.
Cheers.